We are more than just talk.
The dialogue. The community voice of Southern California's Young Professional Network. Relevant discussions about the thoughts, concerns, opportunities, and challenges faced by today's generational leaders.
Real talk, real people.
This is The Dialogue.
The Dialogue
with Starlett Quarles
on LA Talk Live
and streaming live
at www.latalklive.com.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome once again to The Dialogue, Real Talk, Real People. I'm your host, Starlett Quarles, and we're on live at latalklive.com and streaming all over your internet. And as always, The Dialogue is the voice of our generation, so thank you so much for joining us here every Wednesday from 5 to 6:30, where we like to discuss the topics that are relevant to today's generational leaders. Tonight, we are concluding our five-week series on the intergenerational curses of slavery and racism. I hope you have enjoyed this five-week series. This past 4 weeks, I have learned so much, and I hope you have too. So just to recap some of the things that we have already talked about this month, we started this series off talking about the legacy of slavery. We followed that up with the Willie Lynch letter and the breakdown of the black family. Then we went into Sarah Bartman and the objectification of black women. And last week, if you joined us, we discussed Black Wall Street and our economic development. And tonight we are concluding this series by talking about our healing. How do we heal? How do we heal from slavery and racism? We've already acknowledged this month that there are absolutely some intergenerational effects as it relates to slavery, whether they're psychological, mental, social, economical, or political. But we've also discussed and acknowledged on this show that slavery and the history of our ancestors is not something that we often talk about in the black community. And I've just asked this all throughout this month. Why don't we talk about it? Nor are we compelled to teach it to our children. So as a people, how can we heal? How can we heal if we don't want to talk about slavery and the legacy of our resilience? And the resilience from our African ancestors. This is just one of many questions that we hope to address tonight on our show. Our guests include Associate Pastor Victor Cyrus Franklin, Publisher Pierre Harbin, Senior Pastor Dr. Louis Logan II, and Clinical Psychologist Dr. Brickell Quarles, all here tonight to help me conclude our month-long series on the intergenerational curses of slavery and racism. As always, each week, this is a community conversation, so we definitely want to hear from you. 323-473-3100, 323-473-3100, or you can post your comments or your questions on our Facebook page at facebook.com/thedialoguela, or tweet me at StarQuar, or if you have the Twitter or Facebook account of our guests, tweet them your comment or your question, and we hope to be able to get to all of them tonight. And you can also, of course, stay connected to us on our website at thedialoguela.com, or if you've missed any of these past episodes or any of our previous shows, you can go to our website and check out the replays. If you missed any of the series, it'll be right there. And join our mailing list so that we can keep you connected and in tune to our weekly series and topics that we have coming up right here on The Dialogue. We're going to take a quick commercial break. And when we come back, we're going to jump into our conversation for tonight on healing from slavery and racism with me, Starlett Quarles, right here on The Dialogue, Real Talk, Real People. We'll be right back. To die. Cause I don't know what's up there beyond the sky. It's been a long time coming, but I know change gon' come. Oh, yes, it will. I go to the movie.
Designs by Ardina, preserving heritage and building legacies through art. Turn your favorite photos into personalized, one-of-a-kind, customized artwork. Designs by Ardina offers innovative and creative options for printing on aluminum, acrylic, canvas, with custom framing and matting services available upon request. Designs by Ardina also offers photo restoration, portrait art, digital photo albums, and even basic business printing services. For more information and a customized quote, visit www.designsbyardina.com. That's www.designsbyardina.com. Or call 323-455-1251. That's 323-455-1251. Designs by Ardina, proud sponsors of LA Talk Live and the Talk Live Broadcast Network.
Interested in advertising your business, product, or service here on The Dialogue? The Dialogue will help you promote your business, increase your traffic,
and bring in new clients
through innovative and creative marketing packages, including affordable radio ad campaigns for small businesses. Go to www.thedialoguela.com
or call 323-475-8729. That's 323-475-8729. 323-475-8729.
And now, back to The Dialogue.
The Dialogue.
With Starlett Quarles.
Real talk. Real people.
Welcome back to The Dialogue, Real Talk, Real People. I'm your host, Starlett Quarles, and tonight we are concluding our month-long series on the intergenerational curses of slavery and racism with tonight's conversation on healing from slavery and racism. The phone lines are open, so give us a call here, 323-473-3100, 323-473-3100. So I'm going to jump right into our conversation, and let me start off by introducing our guests, starting off with Victor Cyrus Franklin, who is an associate pastor with Holman United Methodist Church right here in Los Angeles, California. A native of Nashville, Tennessee, he is a son of a pastor and public school teacher and has a passion for ministry that fosters intergenerational dialogue and growth. As a result, he leads an intergenerational ministry at Holman with attention to nurturing the struggle for social change. He previously served as advocacy organizer for the General Commission on Religion and Race at the United Methodist Church and on the pastoral staff of East Point First Malalu.
Malalu.
You knew I was going to get it wrong.
Yeah.
Malalu.
Yeah.
UMC in Atlanta, Georgia. He's a graduate of Tennessee State University in Nashville and Gammon Seminary of the Interdenominational Theological Center in Atlanta. And all month long, ladies and gentlemen, we have been talking about and promoting the series Underground on WGN America. And Victor is the author of this faith study guide that we're going to be referencing, and he's going to let you know how you can get it at the end. But it's absolutely fabulous. It's something that you should definitely use and discuss as you're watching this series, and I hope you're watching this series along with your family. So please welcome Mr. Victor Cyrus Franklin, pastor.
All right, thank you so much.
To the dialogue. So we were just talking about your ability to be able to kind of surmise this information. And what was, you know, ironic about as I was reading this is that the intent is for it to read it as a family. But I'm asking, like, at the beginning, you know what I mean? This is something that we don't talk about.
Absolutely.
Yeah. as a people. So I just commend you, one, for pulling this document together. And I hope that, and we're going to talk about some of the series that you're going to be doing here locally in Los Angeles, but that families do get together.
Yeah.
And they do answer and take some critical thinking into some of the questions that you're posing for Underground and the series. So again, thank you so much, and we're definitely going to reference your document today. I'm also joining us my good friend Pierre Harbin. Welcome back. He helped launch this series where we talked about the legacy of slavery. He is the publisher of Golden Age, a World Heritage publication concerned with African Islamic world affairs, culture, and architecture, and has been publishing articles on his site since 2012. He is also a property development professional specializing in historic preservation, new markets, and sustainable design. Pierre says he self-identifies as Black American, a descendant of African people who arrived on the shores of North America as an import for slave trade and who sustained a struggle for survival and liberation in this section of the world nearly 400 years ago. You said we're approaching the 400th year.
Yes, 2019.
Of our landing. The institution of slavery.
Yes, 1619 in Jamestown.
Mm-hmm. Pierre believes that what is meant by the term survival of African Americans is one, to resist systematic oppression and genocide, and two, to recover the self, which entails a psychological recovery from abuse and dehumanization of political oppression and exploitation, recovery of African heritage, culture, and values that were repressed during slavery. That's a lot.
Yes.
We got a lot to go through.
Yes, it is.
In order to be able to, survive on what it means to be African American here today. So thank you so much for coming back.
I
appreciate you. And looking forward to having you join us for today's conversation on the phone. And you guys know I rarely take guests over the phone, but I had to take this one because it's my older sister, Dr. Raquel Quarles, who is a clinical. Thanks, Richard. The sister shout out, who is a clinical supervisor at Rikers Island Correctional Facility in New York City. Ever since she was a young girl, Raquel knew she would one day become a doctor. What she did not know, however, was that after completing her doctorate degree in clinical psychology, she would end up spending 11 years of her life in one of the most notorious correctional facilities in America. You in the belly of the beast, Raquel?
I'm in the belly of the beast.
In the belly of the beast. Yeah, we can hear you perfect. Doing good work in the belly of the beast. After graduating from UCLA with a bachelor's degree in psychobiology, Dr. Quarles earned 3 masters in biology, psychology, and theology prior to completing her doctorate, an educational journey that today, as you can see, my father pressed education. An educational journey that today allows her to integrate the dynamics of mind, body, and spirit when analyzing human behavior. With a special interest in examining the intergenerational effects of trauma, which is something we'll talk about today, especially when it comes to slavery, Dr. Quarles strives to empower others to understand the influence life events have on reshaping our lives, stories, our life stories, and God's given potential. After counseling several inmates at Rikers, Dr. Quarles began to realize the abundance of young men who possess misguided and untapped potential. Along with this came a clear understanding of the psychopolitical issues shaping the cradle-to-prison pipeline that exists for most of our young Black and brown men today. So please welcome my sister, my mentor, my role model, Dr. Raquel Quarles. Hi, sis.
Thank you.
How you doing?
I'm doing well. I'm glad to be here.
Thank you so much for taking the time to join us for this conversation. I mean, my sister and I talk about this all the time, especially when it comes to dealing with shame and trauma and the mass incarceration of Black men. So, Raquel, I'm going to start off with you and to pose a question that I posed at the top of the show and all throughout this series. Why do you believe Black America, Black people, Black community, why don't we want to talk about slavery and the legacy of our ancestors?
I feel part of the reason is many of us feel we know what we need to know,
mm-hmm.
and but the deeper issue is that it's really shaming to talk about.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I believe that the reason that is because when slavery is taught either in school or there are shows or movies about it, it's not told as a story of triumph.
Right.
But instead told as a story of defeat.
Yes.
So, people don't want to hear about being defeated.
Mm-hmm.
If it was told in a different way, however, I think it would be more of a story that we'd hear about and would want to hear about.
Absolutely.
More so than we do now.
Absolutely. Victor, I see you shaking your head.
Yeah, I just have to agree. I have to concur, wholeheartedly. These are stories that are shameful for mm-hmm. us and difficult to have pride in. And so we don't want to relay them.
Right.
In some ways, we're embarrassed by them mm-hmm. Compared to what we know about other peoples from other places, other cultures, other heritages. And so in that sense, it's very not just the story itself, but how the story is told that informs whether we share it or not.
Absolutely. So if we're not talking about it, Pierre, if we're not talking about it, then how can we begin to heal from it?
We can't, because we're in a denial. We're in a spiritual and mental state of denial of who we are.
Okay.
And by disconnecting from our ancestors, African slave ancestors, we are disconnecting from ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to embrace our history, every part of it, in order to be whole.
Okay. All right. Dr. Quarles, do you agree? I mean, if we're not, if we don't begin to talk about it, if we're not talking about it, then how can we even start healing as a people?
Yeah, I totally agree with that. We can't heal from it, you know. And in order to heal from any kind of issue, the first step is acknowledging that there's a problem that exists, that, you know, we need to heal from. So, you know, not only do we have to acknowledge that there's a problem that needs healing, but we also have to, you know, accept responsibility for our healing.
Right.
You know, we can't leave that for someone else to do and put the responsibility on someone else. You know, we have to also take responsibility for what it is we feel we need to do to better ourselves.
So, in your opinion, what do you believe have been some of the long-term effects of slavery on Black America? Raquel?
Several long-term effects of slavery. And let me preface this by saying, not only for Black people, but also for white folks.
Okay.
But I'll talk about that more so later. But, you know, just the inner sense of feeling inadequate.
Mm-hmm.
And this is, you know, the whole shame piece, feeling inadequate, feeling less than, you know, feeling unworthy, you know, because of, you know, what it meant to be Black, and that shaming, you know, slavery being part of our history.
Okay.
You know, I think there's a whole host of things that stem from feelings of shame, including anger, depression, hopelessness, you know, aggression even. You know, all these different things that we see and how we act out our shame is the result of, you know, slavery's legacy.
Okay. And what would you say, Victor, in terms of long-term effects that we see even manifesting still today?
I mean, there are definitely long-term effects politically, you know, socially, you know, disenfranchisement.
Right.
You know, where our income is, our educational systems. I mean, all those were effects and results of slavery. But in terms of who we are as a people, I mean, definitely low self-esteem. It impacts how we relate to each other and our families. We don't see ourselves as powerful.
Okay.
To impact and affect change. And but all that's connected to, again, how we tell the stories.
And you know, and you guys are laying this kind of plethora of just issues that are continuing to plague us. And it feels like it's even, we need to talk about it. I mean, it was at a point now where we need to talk about it. I mean, when you're talking about anger and depression and all, and those manifest in health issues, mental issues, and all that. So, Pierre, you know, I mean, we're at a point where we need to do this.
Yes, and the Underground series couldn't have come at a better time.
Okay.
Because it is a story of triumph.
Yes, it is.
A 600-mile track to freedom.
Mm-hmm.
And where I'm from, Detroit, just on the other side of the Detroit River in Windsor, Ontario, we have a town called Amherstburg.
Okay.
Amherstburg was founded by our African ancestors who made it to freedom in the North.
Nice.
And that town, that city, that community is still intact. So when we learn of those stories, we can take pride in, in our people's triumph.
And I was telling somebody the other day, before there was even an El Chapo, there was a Harriet Tubman.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
All right. Okay, so, you know, we launched this series talking about the work of Dr. Joy DeGry. Leary, I didn't know until I was mispronouncing her name till I was told later, but DeGry on post-traumatic slave syndrome. So I just kind of want to revisit that definition and kind of go over some of her effects and then get you guys' feedback on that. So Richard, we're going to go with the first slide with the definition of PTSS, post-traumatic slave syndrome, which is a theory that explains the etiology or cause of many of the adaptive survival behaviors in African-American communities throughout the United States and the diaspora. It is a condition that exists as a consequence of multi-generational oppression of Africans and their descendants resulting from centuries of chattel slavery. And you said there's a difference in terms of the types of slavery, in terms of chattel and the economics, and we'll talk about that a little bit later on, Pierre. A form of slavery which was predicated on the belief that African Americans were inherently, genetically inferior to whites. This was then followed by institutionalized racism, which continues to perpetuate injury, thus resulting in what she calls MAP, M-A-P. M, multi-generational trauma, together with continued oppression. A, absence of opportunity to heal or access the benefits available to society. And two, this leads to post-traumatic slave syndrome. And under these circumstances, there are some predictable patterns of behavior that tend to occur. And these key patterns of behaviors are vacant esteem, marked propensity for anger and violence, and racist socialization and internalized racism, which is defined as learned helplessness, literacy deprivation, distorted self-concept, antipathy, and aversion for the following: members of one's own identified culture, ethnic group, the mores and customs associated one's own identified cultural ethnic heritage, and the physical characteristics of one's own identified cultural ethnic group. And these are the key behaviors based on the research of Dr. Joy DeGroy Leary and post-traumatic slavery syndrome. So, Bakir, I'm going to throw it to you. Tell us your thoughts, especially from a clinical perspective, on Dr. DeGroy Leary's post-traumatic slave syndrome.
Well, I definitely agree with her. You know, there is a lot of research that shows that violence and trauma is passed on intergenerationally in various ways. There is psychologist Robert T. Carter, who did some work at the Columbia University, and he's been able to show that, you know, experiences of racial harassment and discrimination can have emotional, psychological effects that match what PTSD looks like. So, you know, just being, you know, racially stigmatized or discriminated can cause you to become fearful, have a lot of tension, anxiety, depression, you know, anger, aggression, you know, suspiciousness. You know, all these just being, you know, racially discriminated.
Right. Okay.
Forget about the whole violence piece, you know, because that takes it even deeper, because trauma is violent experiences that changes your whole being.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And
go ahead.
As far as it being able to, because some people will say, you know, slavery happened a long time ago. You know, how can we still be feeling the effects today? Mm-hmm. And I just want to add this one last point as far as genetically. You know, the research has also shown that genetically experience changes how our genes operate. And if you have a traumatic experience, those traumatic experiences are remembered in your genes.
Wow.
And so you pass down those stuff to your kids and your grandkids. So that's how we can have, you know, somebody who was traumatized during slavery, you know, if their effects weren't healed, then they're passing down that genetic marker all the way to us today. So that's why it's really critical for us to not only talk about slavery, but to get healed from slavery. Because if we don't, we're going to continue to pass these, you know, these genetic markers on to future generations.
Right. Absolutely. Victor, your thoughts on post-traumatic slave syndrome and the intergenerational transfer of trauma?
Yeah. Again, I think it's important to, you know, as we address post-traumatic slave syndrome and intergenerational trauma, again, when we talk about the mediums and the stories, you know, the ways that we respond to it. I mean, I'm reminded in England, in undergraduate school, went to Tennessee State University, historically black college university, majored in English. And it was in the English department there where I was exposed to a number of black writers from the United States and the diaspora. That in some way, I don't know if I would have heard about them anywhere else.
Okay.
And I remember a novel we read, it was titled Stigmata by Phyllis Alicia Perry.
Okay.
And Stigmata, for those who are Roman Catholic, we know about those, our folk who are Roman Catholic know about that with the stigmata of the wounds of Jesus, the Christ. Mm-hmm. And it's a person who today, because of their faith and their relationship, they experience those same wounds. Okay. Well, in this text, however, she wrestles with a character who experiences the wounds from enslavement from her great-great-great, you know, grandmother. When she wraps herself in this patchwork quilt, I mean, she experiences these wounds. And she doesn't know, and because she doesn't know the story, because the story was never told to her, she doesn't understand what it is or where it comes from. And so the novel wrestles with how do we have these conversations in families, you know, to have these difficult conversations, to let the healing, if you will, you know, begin, to break, you know, that curse, to break that chain. And so I think we, all of us, live with that. And one of the things that I think is important about that novel is it makes it clear that that's not a, it's not an experience just for poor black folk. You know, even middle class, upper middle class, back, upwardly mobile, if you will, you know, black folk are wrestling, you know, with this kind of trauma, and we're responding to that, and we are in denial as well. And so it's universal. Furthermore, you know, I would argue, you know, as we talk about, you know, slavery in the United States context, we have to include the larger global history of colonization, because even on the continent of Africa, black folk who, because of that history of colonization, who are dealing with that sense of inferiority, who are beginning replicating the kinds of oppressions that hurt our own people, because of dealing with that trauma and wrestling with that pain, it's important for us to engage, because we're experiencing that here in the United States, but worldwide.
Absolutely. Here, you
and
have to say.
Just to add to what the brother was saying about this global phenomenon of colonization. It is a reflexive behavior. There was a story just recently on PBS about a South African, white South African woman who had her home invaded by three black South African men. It was a home invasion with the intent to rob the home. She had a reflexive reversion back to a dominant authoritative behavior. She began to speak to them as she spoke to them during the period of apartheid. The mother figure, the authoritarian figure. And but what was interesting is that they reverted to a reflexive behavior of submissive. She became a mother figure to them. And so, and that is the lingering effect of the legacy of slavery, that we have been seeded with values and reflective behavior that no matter we go through a master's degree, doctor's degree, we still struggle with this reflex of inferiority.
And when you talk about, you know, just prior to us coming on the show, are going live, we were talking about Underground and the scene where the mother kills the baby because she didn't want the baby born into a life of slavery. And you can just imagine, and that's just a small example of the type of things that were experienced during slavery, but you can just imagine the legacy of not dealing with that. And I think she, they eventually wanted to ship her off, you know what I mean, and not even dealing with this, the psychological trauma of having to kill your baby. Right. Raquel, you have to say anything about the behavioral patterns when it comes to intergenerational transfer of trauma?
Well, it's the same thing. You know, attachment style is someone who hasn't solved their trauma. Let's say someone who's gotten, I don't know, any traumatic event, raped or robbed, 9/11. You know, if you don't resolve that stuff, then you're not going to be able to be emotionally available for your children. You're not going to be able to provide a sense of security for your kids and do other things psychologically and emotionally for your children. So now they're becoming affected by your behavior and developing certain behavior patterns themselves that they will then, if not, you know, dealt with, pass on to their kids and the way they function as adults. So this is how it can be passed on. The behaviors are passed on, you know, from generation to generation.
And that, you know, can also contribute to what we were talking about earlier when we were, you know, discussing Willie Lynch, the breakdown of the black family, right? You know, we talk about taking the man out of the household, but then we really don't reflect on the psychological effects of the breaking down of the black family.
Yeah, I remember, you know, James Baldwin, you know, in his text, The Evidence of Things Not Seen, writing about the Atlanta child murders. I mean, he has a passage in there where he writes about, you know, black families, and he quotes a blues song. He says, there's a blues song where for women, he says, you know, when a woman catches the blues, Lord, she hangs her head and cries. You know, but when a man catches the blues, Lord, he hops on the train and rides.
Wow.
And it's from the sense of powerlessness, you know, okay, inability to support one's family, provide, you know, for one's family, inability to be a man, you know, if you will. And so in that sense, it becomes easier to hop on the train and leave, mm-hmm, versus to stay. And so that becomes a our trauma plays out in those ways.
Absolutely.
You know, right? And that's passed on, you know, with a sense of fatherlessness or father lacking, as some folks would call it. And so that's, you know, that's part of that legacy of enslavement that comes. I mean, even families being separated. I mm-hmm. mean, I recall, you know, scholars, you know, writing about that period, and once called, I can't remember her name off the top of my head, but she had a presentation, and she titled it, you know, "Till Death or Distance Do Us Part." Mm-hmm. And so she said, when enslaved folks would take vows, when our ancestors would take vows, some of them would take the vow "Till death or distance do us part," mm-hmm, because there was no guarantee that tomorrow you would still be together.
Right.
But one of the things that was important that she engaged in that presentation was, they still felt it was a vow worth taking, mm-hmm, right? So, mm-hmm, so in the ways that they wrestled with that trauma and were still became agents, if you will, in negotiating whatever power they had, they said, we do have the power to be there for one another, even for the time that we have now.
Nice.
And so, again, and that becomes critical in terms of looking at the ways, yes, the trauma continues, but also balancing that with, these are the ways that we've explored it in our agency, uh-huh, you know, to respond and to continue to fight for and struggle for our liberation.
Absolutely. Before we go to commercial break, again, I want to encourage you to download Underground, the Faith Study Guide. I hope you are reading the series, watching the series. It is a 10-week series. Tonight is the fourth episode. Where can they get this study guide? What was the website again?
Yeah, you can download it at rebirthlive.net. R-E-B-I-R-T-H-L-I-V-E.
Rebirthlive.net. And before we leave, I just want to read a little bit from your introduction. And the premise of this document is that these are stories of faith. Underground is a story of faith. And our mobilization and our ingenuity as a people. So before we go to commercial break, I just want to read a little bit that you wrote in your introduction. When you talk about the Black Church, you said it's an institution not perceived by slaveholders. The Black Church helped instill in enslaved Africans a sense of personhood, worth, and faith, despite the violence of forced labor, separation of sale of people as property, forbidden marriage, and the seeming unending cruelty of beatings, whippings, or death, if one dared. We're talking about healing from slavery and racism tonight on The Dialogue. We're going to take a quick commercial break, and when we come back, we're going to continue our conversation right here with me, Starlett Quarles. We're going to take a quick commercial break.
Designs by Ardina, preserving heritage and building legacies through art. Turn your favorite photos into personalized, one-of-a-kind, customized artwork. Designs by Ardina offers innovative and creative options for printing on aluminum, acrylic, canvas, with custom framing and matting services available upon request. Designs by Ardina also offers photo restoration, portrait art, digital photo albums, and even basic business printing services. For more information and a customized quote, visit www.designsbyardina.com. That's www.designsbyardina.com. Or call 323-455-1251. That's 323-455-1251. Designs by Ardina, proud sponsors of LA Talk Live and the Talk Live Broadcast Network.
Interested in advertising your business, product, or service here on The Dialogue?
The Dialogue will help you promote your business, increase your traffic,
and bring in new clients
through innovative and creative marketing packages, including affordable radio ad campaigns for small businesses. Go to www.thedialoguela.com
or call 323-475-8729. That's 323-475-8729. 323-475-8729. And now,
back to The Dialogue.
The Dialogue.
With Starlett Quarles.
Real talk. Real people.
Welcome back to The Dialogue. Real talk. Real people. I am your host, Starlett Quarles, and tonight we are concluding our fantastic 5-week series on the intergenerational curses of slavery and racism right here on The Dialogue. And tonight we're talking about healing and how do we heal from slavery and racism. We have an absolutely fantastic panel, and I'm encouraging everyone to please download Pastor Cyrus Franklin's faith study guide, and to continue to watch Underground, because it is a story of faith, it is a story of resilience, and it definitely shows slavery from a different context. And so I want to talk about, in terms of our healing process, we need to start telling a different story, right? So after we acknowledge it, many of you mentioned that we need to begin to start talking about slavery from a different perspective and from a different paradigm. Pierre, talk about that paradigm shift that we need when it comes to changing the story of how we talk about not only slavery, but our life prior to the Middle Passage.
Absolutely. The narrative, as it has been portrayed by the oppressor, has been one of a submissive, defeated human being, dehumanized to the level of animal. And the narrative of our resistance to slavery, the narrative of our triumphant victory over slavery by escaping and into freedom, that narrative have been denied.
And that's all in Underground. You know what I mean? It shows us being treated as hunted as animals. I mean, there, you know, this last week's scene with when the young white boy was with his father, who was a slave catcher, right? And he's taking him out hunting, basically. And the son sees him hunting for slave and the resistance, and the whole premise of this, you know, series is to actually articulate that, right? To show that we were resistant, we were ingenious. Do you know what I mean? In terms of, you know, how we not only survived, but how we were able to maintain aspects of our culture during slavery. Victor?
Absolutely. Yeah, but again, also how the story is told. I mean, even when we say Lincoln freed the slaves, as if the slaves weren't organizing and working, enslaved folks weren't organizing and working themselves to become free, you know? So yes, they were allies. You know, yes, they were folks who we strategically, you know, worked with for that outcome to happen, but it wasn't a gift that we didn't fight for and work for, you know? So again, how is the story told? When it's told from the perspective of that gaze, you know, that white gaze, then our story of resistance becomes lost, and it's important to do that. I think the other thing, too, to complicate it a little bit, and I think the Underground show does this brilliantly, is it says even among ourselves, we may have different conceptions and understandings of what freedom is, you know? And so there's debate within the group, within the Macon Seven, as they're depicted.
Yeah, it is. You do see that, absolutely.
You know, there's different perspective. And so that's important because, again, that humanizes us in such a way. It doesn't romanticize the experience and makes it very real, therefore relatable, as we negotiate and work out what freedom is for us today, and we do that kind of organizing work. There is difference of opinion.
Yeah,
you know, there has been historically, but that's part of what a free people, that's what we do as a free people. You know, we work that out. And so again, I think the show does that brilliantly because we can see ourselves in the different characters as they play out, you know, as we negotiate, you know, what freedom and healing is for us.
Absolutely. And Brickell, your thoughts on the paradigm shift that we need to start not only having when it comes to our ancestry, but what do we need to be telling our kids? What is the story? How are we changing the narrative, as Pierre say, in terms of slavery and our African ancestry?
Well, what we need to do is change what we're saying is bad, you know, about being black. You know, it's interesting to me how you know, there's been a history of being dark-skinned being a bad thing,
mm-hmm.
or having big lips being a bad thing, you know, or having a big booty,
mm-hmm.
you know, being a bad thing. But when the oppressor says it's good, then we change our opinion of that.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, you know, we have to figure out and understand whose opinion are we valuing, and allow our kids to know what is good about them as far as them being black people.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I think the Black Panther movement was so powerful, because it was during that time that black was beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
Black was prideful. You know, black wasn't shameful.
Mm-hmm.
And so if we can tell stories that reflect, you know, black pride, then we can do a lot of things as far as changing our identity and our approach, you know, to life as black folks in America.
Absolutely. You know, and an excellent example of that paradigm shift and how we can, you know, change the conversation with our kids was a story you told me about your son and the report that he did on Jackie Robinson and his, you know, distinction between Jackie Robinson's inability to go into a bathroom because he was black. You know what I mean?
Yes.
He couldn't go into a white bathroom because he would.
Yes.
Share with our audience that story, because I think this is a fantastic example of how we can start. Your son is 9.
Yeah, 9 years old.
Okay, and so, and you said, you know, personally, you think, you know, he's probably a little bit too young, you know what I mean, for you guys to start studying this series with him. But there are ways in which that you can start instilling this paradigm shift when it comes to, especially our black boys. So would you, if you would share that audience, share with our audience.
Yeah, there are ways to tell the story. I mean, it's just like our ancestors went with television, and when we saw Tarzan and we saw black people on the television screen and we were excited, there are black people on the television. But at the same time, you need to understand that's not who we are.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's a racist depiction.
Mm-hmm.
We need to offer that kind of filter. And so for us, you know, for our son, we try to do the same thing. I mean, he has had a book report, you know, to write over the course of spring break, you
mm-hmm.
know, on Jackie Robinson. And so he did his research, he had his books, he went to websites and watched some YouTube videos, you know, to learn what he could learn.
Mm-hmm.
And so as he writes it, one of the things he writes is that when he played for the Brooklyn Dodgers, he couldn't go to the same hotels, you know, as the other players went to. And I said, well, why not? He said, well, they wouldn't accept him because he was black.
Mm-hmm.
And so my wife and I both said, whoa, slow down. There's nothing wrong with being black. The problem isn't his blackness. The problem is that they were racist.
Absolutely.
You know,
absolutely.
That's what the problem is. And so when we talk about the problem as if we are the problem, we reinscribe white supremacy,
mm-hmm.
and we reinscribe that sense of self-inferiority and black inferiority. And so we coached him and walked him through how to tell the story in such a way that Jackie Robinson and his blackness are not the problem here, but the problem is the white racism, you know, of the owners, the hotels, you know, the society itself. And but yet in the midst of that, Jackie Robinson was able to accomplish these things.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the other thing, even connected to that, we didn't talk about this earlier, but connected to that, I emphasize, well, Jackie Robinson didn't start playing baseball in Major League Baseball with the Brooklyn Dodgers. He played in the Negro Leagues. He
mm-hmm.
played in Kansas City Monarchs.
Mm-hmm.
And he wasn't the best player in the Negro Leagues, you know, but he was the one they felt who was most appropriate in that space, in that venue,
right.
But he wasn't the best player.
Right.
And so again, because this is what we're dealing with, you know, in our educational system. So he says, also, the Negro Leagues weren't as good as Major League Baseball. Whoa, slow down.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and so when we uncover and tell the story, you know, putting ourselves at the center of the story, and then that, you know, that sense of our history and our heritage begins to shift and change. And I know for him, we have to work with that constantly, because again, it's in the DNA of our society and our culture.
Yeah, you said you had to, you know, talk to him about Trayvon Martin.
Absolutely, yeah, Trayvon Martin, Michael,
you know,
Brown,
all that at 9.
You know, we have to do that, because again, I mean, when we watch the news, we watch the news together, you know, as a family, and we see that and encounter that, they criminalize these young people. There had to be some reason for them to get killed, even though they were unarmed.
Okay.
And so he begins to believe that, but no, that's not the case. That's not the real problem.
Absolutely fantastic. I believe we have a caller, Richard. Hi, caller. You're on with the dialogue. You have a comment or question for our guest?
Yes, I have a comment, and it might turn into a question. My name is Eddie Price. I'm down here.
Eddie Price in San Diego, California. How you doing, sir?
I'm all right.
Fantastic.
You know, I'm just a black man, you know, and oftentimes when we talk about fixing ourselves, we don't know at what point did we get broke.
Mm.
You know, we talk about our ancestors, but we don't go far enough back in our ancestry.
Mm-hmm.
We just go forefathers back. My father, his father, and his father.
Mm-hmm.
We don't go back to what are we trying to fix ourselves to?
Mm. Excellent.
Because if we just focus on slavery, we're just trying to make ourselves, we're trying to accept slavery. and make ourselves more comfortable with it so we can become more docile in our living in this country.
Okay.
You know, it's not just an intellectual thing, but it's a spiritual thing.
Okay.
And we've lost our spirituality, you know, and I don't want to offend any Christians.
No,
but,
I might do that later on.
Yeah, it goes a little bit further than just, you know, how can we deal with what's happened to us in this country?
Okay.
What were we before we got here, before there was apartheid in South Africa? What are we trying to return to?
Okay, fantastic question. Pierre, I'm gonna throw that one to you.
Well, 1619, that was the year that's given as the beginning of slavery in North America, what we call the United States. We know as early as 1565 in Spanish Florida, there were Africans enslaved there, but we go with 1619 because that was the beginning of slavery in what we call today North America or United States. 28 years prior to 1619, the year was 1591, in West Africa, the Songhai Empire stretched from the Atlantic Ocean to the Red Sea. It was the largest African empire in West African history and the fourth largest empire in Islamic history.
Mm.
So 28 years out of an empire,
mm-hmm.
We landed on the shores of North America as slaves.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not possible for us to have forgotten. It's like an Italian forgetting he was in Rome,
right,
28 years ago.
Okay.
So that's what we're getting back to. We got 2 million manuscripts that's over 700 years old documenting the literary heritage of West Africa. Astronomy, medicine, health, government, art, science,
and
philosophy.
And this is where? Where do you get this?
This is in Timbuktu.
Okay.
And Timbuktu, unlike the European capitals of the world at that time, their number one commodity was books.
Mm.
They sold more books than any other commodity. So that's where our closest link to our African ancestors in terms of power and strength.
Okay.
But we cannot look over the value, the spiritual value of our African enslaved ancestors here in North America, because those people were tested by God. And mm-hmm. they should be looked upon and revered by our people like we revere the people of the Quran and the Bible.
Okay.
There should be no people in the Bible or the Holy Quran more holier than the African slaves in North America. Why? Because, like the Underground Railroad show us, they got through the experience.
Yes, they did.
And they survived.
Yes,
and
they
we're
did.
Evidence of their survival.
Absolutely.
So God tested them and he proved them worthy. So we should revere them. We should commemorate every event along the Underground Railroad.
Absolutely.
Like the Jews revere and commemorate the Passover.
And so that's a fantastic segue into the question that I was going to ask Victor. But before I do that, on the first show, when we had Gail here and we had the actual shackles, you know what I mean, that we wore in the Middle Passage. And just to kind of, you know, revisit the fact that we were shackled that way for 6 months in close quarters, being sick, defecating, and the only ones that survived that passage were the strong.
Yes.
Because the dead they threw over. So we are.
Yes.
Or
a
some
legacy.
Of us jumped.
And
or some of us jumped. Okay.
Before I be a slave, I'll be buried in my grave
okay.
and go home to my Lord and be free. You know,
very
for
good.
For some of us, that was preferable destiny than living through that.
Okay.
So there was still agency there.
Okay. All right. And even still, that is brave in and of itself.
Right.
Do you
right.
know what I mean? To have that type of mental strength to be able to
right.
do that.
25% died within 7 years of being here.
Mm.
So we are the offspring of the worthy.
Of the strongest.
Of the very strongest.
Of the very strongest.
The ones that God approved.
We need to find out what made them strong.
God, yeah. Faith. What would you say?
I would say that
we are who we are.
You know, if you read the old Negro spirituals that was sung by our ancestors, they were singing freedom songs.
Okay.
Right.
They were singing Jeremiah, come back. Oh, Daniel, come back. These were freedom, liberation songs. Our
okay.
people had freedom on their mind from the
freedom,
day we
freedom on their mind.
From the moment
thank you
we
for the call, Eddie.
On the shores.
Thank you for your call, Eddie. But I wanted to make this transition when we talk about the the Jews and how they will never let you forget the Holocaust, right? Mm-hmm. They won't forget it. They won't let you forget it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, prior to me, you know, doing the series, I had someone come up to me and say, oh, well, stop talking about, you know, slavery, or, you know, you don't need to be talking about that, or why don't you talk about something else? I said, I wish a Jew would go up to another Jew and say that. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, the mere fact that you feel comfortable enough to tell me right. that I should want to talk about mm-hmm. slavery in any capacity. But one of the things that you said, that what we don't do, that the Jews do when it comes to the Holocaust, is that we don't survive, what did you say, survive slavery, that they were heroes right. and not victims. Right. And that we don't have a sense of pride in that, because there is no sense of heroism mm-hmm. when it comes to slavery. And that is some of the things that you kind of depict when you were talking to your son. So talk about, you know, slavery in terms of them being heroes and changing that paradigm and that conversation at that level.
Yeah, again, it's the way we tell the story. I mean, I can't say that enough.
Right.
I know that, you know, for us, you know, in our family, again, when we talk about the Jews, I mean, we're talking about an institution, right? Mm-hmm. We're talking about the synagogue. We're talking about spaces and places where they come and learn the heritage. You learn Hebrew. You learn your story. You learn your people's story. So even those who no longer believe in God, right, they still consider themselves to be Jews and connected to that story and right. that narrative. And they have that identity, you know, connected to that. You know, for us, we haven't done a good enough job in our own institutions to codify and relay that story to generations following. Mm-hmm. I mean, the church and too many churches have abandoned, you know, that history and that heritage. Too many of our schools that remain, you know, have abandoned that history and that heritage. It's important to have these black spheres where those stories are institutionalized, therefore shared, and to impact the young, the minds and the spirits and the souls of these young people so that they can see themselves as powerful. So that sense of heroism comes from having the institutional context that impart that into our young people.
And one of the things
them, we can't do
that I appreciate that you do, and I was trying to, you know, to help my sister make a connection, is with the Freedom Schools.
Right.
And because the Jews have, you know, they have schools on Saturday. The Koreans got schools on Saturday where they were outside of the regular academic calendar, where they're teaching them about their culture and their history. And so, Raquel, I just want to kind of get your insight on the need to, in terms of healing, having the story of slavery being told as a story of heroism, and what type of impact do you think that would have on many of our black youth?
I think it would have a dramatic impact. I mean, it's something that's necessary, not to be done just, you know, as a lesson for 1 month or whatever. But this is something that has to be done daily, because daily we are getting messages from society, be it through music, television, you know, the news, whatever it is, society in general, that we are less than, you know, we are inadequate, you know, we are inferior. Mm-hmm. And so we have to counteract those messages on a daily basis. And I think doing that empowers, you know, black kids to be the strong, you know, black people that they are themselves, mm-hmm. and not accept what society says about them, but have something to counteract those messages from someone that they can trust and believe in and gain, you know, consistent support from. So I think it's crucial for us to, you know, feed positive messages about how we were strong, like you were just mentioning, being able to survive the Middle Passages, you know, what we actually went through and how we were able to survive that. Because there was a reason why we were chosen, you know, as Africans to be enslaved over, you know, white folks or Indians. And it was because of our strength. Mm-hmm. You know, one of the reasons was because of our strength, you know, as Africans, to be able to do the work and to deal with what it took to work those fields. And mm-hmm. for the length of time, we were forced to work those fields. Mm-hmm. You know, we have to remember that slavery was about making money, and that's the reason why, you know, black folks, that's one of the reasons why black folks were chosen, because, you know, they couldn't run away and get lost in the crowd, you know, like white indentured servants could. Mm-hmm. You know, they didn't have any rights, legal rights, to begin to own property after their, you know, time of doing the work was over. You know, mm-hmm. indentured servitude was for a limited amount of time, whereas, you know, slavery, chattel slavery in particular, was for a lifetime. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so, you know, being chosen and being able to do the work and be efficient at it and being cheap labor, you know, was one of the main reasons, you know, why Africans were chosen. But because we were able to be strong and we're still surviving today, you know, given the oppression and violence that we consistently face on a daily basis, you know, says a lot about who we are as people.
Absolutely.
So our kids need to know that, you know, we are survivors and we are strong, and we aren't what society would like for us to believe that we are. I think a lot of our healing is prevented because, you know, white society needs to believe, and they need for us to believe that we are inferior, and for them to believe that they are superior to us.
Right.
And in order for racism to go away, you know, white folks have to deal with their own shame and insecurities about being white, compared to, you know, black folks. And until they're able to deal with their stuff, you know, we're not going to be able to totally be free if we're not feeding our kids these messages, because they're going to continue to feed our children, you know, negative messages about themselves, because that helps them to stay in their positions of power.
Absolutely. Victor, do you want to say?
Yeah, I think another thing I think is important on this journey, you know, toward healing, you know, and ongoing healing, is the capacity to think critically and question, right? When we look at Jewish religion and Jewish philosophy, one of the things that's important there is creating spaces to help them create the capacity to question, even question God if need be, if you have a question, right? Because God can handle the questions. And I think for us, when we talk about heroism in part is connected to the capacity to question the world as it is and to vision a better world and to work to create that world.
Okay.
If we're not equipped with critical thinking skills to question the world around us, and if we're not encouraged to wrestle with those questions, you know, as they emerge, and the very difficult ones, then we passively accept the world as it is and negotiate it, because and I think when we look at, you know, the great women, you know, and men who we celebrate, you know, Harriet Tubman was one who questioned her world and her reality was working to create a different kind of world.
Yes,
right?
She was.
And so it's about more than just conveying a history and stories and narratives and facts like a repository that deposit, you know, in children's minds and in our minds, even, you know, as adults, that we can then spew out. But it's about creating that capacity to think and reflect and question. And out of that, we can imagine a different kind of world and a better world. Our ancestors, even those who were enslaved, they had the capacity to think critically. Otherwise, how else can you create Negro spirituals with dual messages?
How else can you create chitlins?
How else can you do? You can't do that unless you have that kind of creativity and that capacity for critical thought. And so, and that was what we had to hide in some ways, because when you have, you know, slave masters, you know, and others who have to think of us as folks who can't think, but they see that we are thinking because we're looking to run away, right? We have folks who are grinding glass in the master's food and letting them eat it and see, you know, see what the outcome is.
Right.
I mean, we're thinking critically. And I think when we see ourselves in that way, regardless of what the conditions appears to be on the outside, then that's the source of a kind of a healing and a kind of a liberation.
But you also see it when, you know, and we're going to constantly be talking about underground, not only with the Negro spirituals, were they giving messages of freedom, and relaying a map, do you know what I mean, through these songs, but they also wrote it out in blood. You know, the episode where one of the slaves left a map, and they couldn't read, and one person could read, but it was in blood, right? So just talk about just the ingenuity and the creativity that we have as a people, that we need to continue to instill in our kids and pass down that aspect of who we are.
Yes, freedom was inseparable from our worship of our ancestors. Salvation in the Hebrew language literally means to make free, set free. And so our quest for freedom was inseparable from our worship. And this is the thing that our children have to understand, that our people had a very clear vision of what worship meant to them.
Yes, it did.
What religion meant to them.
Mm-hmm.
The end result was to be set free.
Yeah.
They had a hope. They put their hope in the promise. The promise was that when Jesus come back, the promise was that he would come back. The hope was that when he do come back, he would come back as Moses and set them free. And so this was, I think, Luke 4. You know, when the ministry of Jesus is defined as one who will restore sight, heal broken hearts, set free the captives, and liberate the oppressed.
Now, Pierre, you said, you know, when we talked earlier, that part of your personal healing came from not only when you embraced the positive aspects of slavery, but that when you did do your research prior to the Middle Passage. I mean, I've said it on the show many times. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, I grew up watching Roots. I grew up watching Roots with my family.
Yes.
And on that very first episode, mm-hmm. I remember, and I saw it recently as an adult, so I'm sure I didn't take it from that perspective, mm-hmm. seeing it as a child of the 70s. But when recently revisiting it as an adult, I saw how there was a rite of passage mm-hmm. with the black boys at 15, mm-hmm. and the fathers took the boys away to build their huts and to create mm-hmm. their sense of independence. Mm-hmm. And then I look back today and we have, you know, all these single-headed households and some of these fathers who don't want to be fathers, right?
Yes,
and some of these
yes.
fathers who are having multiple mothers. So there mm-hmm. was a sense, we had a sense of family, we had a sense of culture, we had a mm-hmm. sense of ritual mm-hmm. On that first episode of Roots prior to, mm-hmm. You know, them bringing them over mm-hmm. through the Middle Passage.
Yes.
And so, but you said once you started doing research, and this was as an adult.
It was a healing process for me. Just studying our ancestors and our history, I felt a renewal mm-hmm. of spirit and of mind.
And this is as an adult?
As an adult.
Okay.
I had already served in the Marine Corps. I was an adult. You know, I was in my late 20s. And when I began my studies, serious studies, mm-hmm. and of our history, you know, through the period of Egypt, our ancient Egyptology, the ancient Egyptian history of our people, studying the freedom fighters on the continent, Kwame Nkrumah, Nelson Mandela, Jomo Kenyatta, Patrice Lumumba.
These are people not taught in public school, let alone in our personal homes if we don't
yes.
know about them. Okay.
And these freedom fighters, this liberation movement on the continent of Africa was like medicine for me,
mm-hmm.
and in terms of reconnecting myself with a sense of self.
Right.
Who am I? And mm-hmm. That's where the healing comes from.
Okay.
Is this discovery of a sense of self.
Okay. And you know, one thing that has been consistent throughout all of my adult guests that I've had mm-hmm. on this show is that they came to some type of epiphany at an adult point in their life, whether they had I had one gentleman who had been out of the who had been a Black Panther and had been out of, you know, the civil rights in 20 years. He had been incarcerated, and then there was this need for him to seek self, right? There was this need for him to go further back and to find some sense of identity of who he is. And Brickell, for you, we often talk about Willie Lynch, and you know, I remember you saying, and we both graduated from UCLA, we didn't learn about Willie Lynch in UCLA, you know what I mean? And you know, what was your response when you first read the Willie Lynch letter, irrespective of its authenticity? What was your response when you read the Willie Lynch letter?
Well, when I read the Willie Lynch letter for the first time, I felt like I had found the white man's playbook because it detailed exactly how to make a slave, you know, how to break them down psychologically, you know, control their mind in order to, you know, get their bodies to work for you. You know, how to break up the family and why that's important. You know, how to manipulate the mother so that she's on your side, you know, as far as the white man's side, and in order to get her children, and her male children in particular, you know, to be docile and easier to control. So to me, it broke down psychologically what was done in order to enslave and oppress, you know, black people. So at that point, I was like, okay, now that we know what was done psychologically, all we have to do is figure out how to do the reverse in order to empower us as people so that we don't have to continue to deal with this oppression, you know, and subjugation, and we can be, you know, who God created us to be.
Absolutely.
So that's how I felt. I felt like I found the white man's playbook.
Found the white man's playbook. We are talking about healing from slavery and racism here on The Dialogue. When we come back, Brickell, I want to talk to you about, you know, the mass incarceration of black men, because like we had said at the top of the show, you are in the belly of the beast at Rikers Island Correctional Facility in New York City. So when we come back, we're going to talk to Brickell about the parallels between slavery and mass incarceration of black men. And for those of you who are familiar with Michelle Alexander's book, The New Jim Crow, she talks a lot about this subject. We're going to take a break and we'll be right back. Make sure you give us a call here, 323-473-3100. We'll be right back. Yeah.
Hi, this is Rhonda Ray, inviting you to join us every Thursday, 6 p.m. Pacific, for Hot Chicks Live. Join us as we discuss the latest fashion, entertainment, sports, and more. So don't forget to tune in to Hot Chicks Live every Thursday, 6 p.m. Pacific, exclusively on LATalkLive.com. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio R&B, Live 365, Radio Flag, TuneIn Radio, AHA Radio, TiVo Radio, and Apple TV Radio, or watch and listen directly at LATalkLive.com. Reality radio handcrafted for your listening and viewing pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Hey, hey, shout us out. What's the count? I'm your host. I am WDC. Tune in to WDC Radio on LA Talk Live every Saturday at 4 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, 7 p.m. Eastern Time for sickle cell trait awareness, lupus, bullying, mental health, and all different aspects of life. So tune in to WDC Radio right here on LA Talk Live. Also, you can listen to us on iTunes, Live 365, YouTube, and Ustream. And don't forget Apple TV and Roku right here on LA Talk Live, where we're more than just talk. Shout us out. What's the count?
Interested in advertising your business, product, or service here on The Dialogue? The Dialogue will help you promote your business, increase your traffic,
and bring in new clients
through innovative and creative marketing packages, including affordable radio ad campaigns for small businesses. Go to www.thedialoguela.com
or call 323-475-8729. That's 323-475-8729. 323-475-8729. And now,
back to The Dialogue.
The Dialogue.
With Starlett Quarles.
Real talk. Real people.
All's my life I has to fight. All's my life I. Hard times like yeah. Bad trips like yeah.
We gonna be all right, y'all. We gonna be all right, because we talking about healing tonight. Healing from slavery and racism right here on The Dialogue. Give us a call, 323-473-3100, 323-473-3100, or post your comments or your question on our Facebook page at facebook.com/TheDialogueLA. And quick shout out to my girl Sheila Taylor tuning in tonight. Thank you, Sheila Bear, for joining us for our conversation on the healing from slavery and racism. So, Raquel, I wanted to come to you because one of the things that you had mentioned is that in terms of our healing, it's hindered by white people. And in terms of them not dealing with their own personal shame. And I know when I was talking to a guest earlier, one of the things that he had mentioned was that white people tended to dehumanize themselves and their children, and they rob their children of their own humanity. And we see that, and I think he paralleled this, or he had reflected on a Dr. Joy Leary's a speech that she was saying. And she said, you know, she was speaking to an audience of white people, and she said, you know, if I were to kill a dog, and we all see this with Michael Vick, right, then you guys want to incarcerate me, beat me, you want to have, you know, all kind of issues. But you had your kids at hangings, you had your kids at lynchings, your kids watched you kill us, beat us, rape us, do you know what I mean? And that was passed down intergenerationally for your children to become desensitized to how black people are treated, specifically black men, here in America. So, Bakil, when you talk about our healing being hindered by the shame of white people, please elaborate on that.
Well, shame requires a cover-up, because no one wants to be exposed, but they don't want their shame exposed. And so what I mean by that is white people don't want to deal with slavery, or they don't want to acknowledge it, because it's based off of white superiority, you know, shame and racism, based off of white superiority. So in order to deal with their shame, they have to acknowledge that they are not superior. Mm. But racism allows them to continue to cover up that fact, because racism continues white supremacy, you know, and everything that comes along with that ideology.
Okay.
So, racism allows them to not deal with their shame. So they need racism to exist so they won't have to be exposed for who they really are.
Mm-hmm.
But what that does for us, it can, if we don't, counter it, limit our ability to believe other than what they're saying about us.
Mm.
So if we're not strong in our own minds to think for ourselves and to know that what they're saying is not true, then we will fall and continue to be in that trap. I mean, if you oppress someone for a certain amount of time without them changing, they end up becoming their own oppressor.
Mm-hmm.
So if it gets to a point where, we don't do something different, we're going to basically do for them what they've been doing all along. Like one of the callers said, learning about slavery is going to do nothing but make us docile. I beg to differ. I feel like, to a degree, we're in a docile, state of mind right now.
Mm-hmm.
And, if once healing from slavery, it will counter that and make us stronger-minded people and have a greater ability to defend against the oppression that we receive on a regular basis.
So, in working with the, male inmates at Rikers, tell us some of the things that you see in terms of some of the intergenerational impacts of slavery and manifest, especially when it comes to the mass incarceration of young boys, because I know you deal with the youth population. So talk about your experience at Rikers and in dealing with the types of trauma that these incarcerated youth are dealing with in their personal lives.
Well, we definitely see a lot of anger, a lot of frustration, a lot of depression, and a lot of anxiety. These kids are coming from families sometimes, communities oftentimes, that are very violent in and of themselves. And the jail system is even more violent and oppressive.
Mm-hmm.
So when you think about slavery and you think about mass incarceration, the two experiences are very similar, and they're similar for a reason. Like I mentioned before, slavery was about making money. And there's a term in business where it's called human capital. And human capital are those things, capital are those things, those assets in your business that make your business more profitable. Human capital relates to the people that are your employees. What business owners will do to increase their profits, they'll invest in their employees. So they'll send them to training. They'll do things that make their employees better, workers, so that the company will make more money.
Mm-hmm.
Now, take this into slavery. Slave owners, in order to make more money, they became more oppressive and more violent.
Mm.
And you notice that when you look at movies like 12 Years a Slave. When they didn't meet the quota, they got a beating.
Mm-hmm.
So when you think about jail systems, jails are violent and oppressive. Certain communities that are poverty stricken are violent and oppressive. There's certain families that have, histories of trauma or whatever, that are violent and oppressive. And the reason why that's important is because having those experiences limits someone's potential. And when you're in a violent and oppressive household, family, community, what have you, your likelihood of becoming incarcerated increases. So when we don't invest in our communities, our families, our schools, we are increasing the chances that our young men and women are going to be locked up.
Okay.
And that benefits people who make money from mass incarceration.
Okay, fantastic. One of the things that Underground talks about, in addition to the bravery and the ingenuity, is it spotlights our sense of faith, right? Mm-hmm. But in terms of today, what has happened to the Black church? In terms of mobilizing us as a family, it's different than it looked in the 60s in the civil rights movement. So I want to start with you. How has the Black church failed this generation?
Well, I think it's important not to paint the Black church with a broad brush.
Okay,
because
fair enough.
All Black churches have historically been prophetic.
Okay.
Not all Black churches, have historically been on the right side of history, if you will. And so that's important. Even in the era of the Black Freedom Movement, we call it the Civil Rights Movement, but it's, the Black Freedom Movement with King. Not all Black churches supported King. That's
mm-hmm.
why they had to start the Progressive National Baptist Convention.
Okay.
Because not all were on the same page.
Okay.
And so I think that's important when we look at the tradition traditions, you know, of the black church, and the question is, which lineage are we a part of, okay. right? And so there are still those who stand in that tradition and who build on it, and there are others who still exist in a tradition of propping up the status quo.
Okay.
And I think, and again, I think those kinds of distinctions are important. I think, and one way I respond to that question is this: when people ask me about the church, I say, do you define, especially church and hip hop culture? I mean, we started off, you know, with Kendrick Lamar, and he opens that song All Right with a biblical reference. You know, mm-hmm. Nazareth. Can anything good come from Nazareth, where Jesus is from? I'm messed up, you messed up, but if God got us, then we're gonna be all right.
Right.
You know. And so when people ask me about that, I say, well, you can't define hip hop by everything you see on television,
mm-hmm.
because there's a whole movement of hip hop that doesn't get access. I say,
right.
similarly, it's the case for the church. You get access to these kinds of media and these kinds of forms, these popular forms, because you're communicating a neoliberal, you know, prosperity theology that aligns, you know, with an oppressive status quo. That's how you get these platforms,
okay.
right?
Mm-hmm.
But those who are doing the hard work don't get that same kind of access. So mm-hmm. As it relates to popular culture, I think it's the same thing, you know, with regard to the church. Again, we're talking about the Underground Railroad. It's underground. It's not seen. It's not perceived.
Nice.
Right? But it's doing the hard work of organizing people, you know, toward this freedom and liberation
okay.
effort. And I think that's the same thing for churches.
Okay, fantastic. So what I want to do is I want to read an excerpt from, and I'm going to come to you, Pierre, after I read this excerpt that my good friend Pierre Harbin referred to me. And it is a jewel. It's a late jewel that came into my life, but it's been around since 1949. In fact, you told me that Martin Luther King carried this book yes. around. It's called Jesus and the Disinherited by Howard Thurman. You're familiar with it, I'm sure. Many of individuals who are in the religious faith or in the religious profession know about Howard Thurman's work. So what I want to do is I want to read a little bit from his preface and chapter one. And I'm going to read these aspects because this is kind of what made him have a paradigm shift when it came to Christianity. And Richard, we're going to start with a preface for Jesus and the Disinherited. He says in the beginning, why is it that Christianity seems impotent to deal radically and therefore effectively with the issues of discrimination and injustice on the basis of race, religion, and national origin? In this impotency of Christianity, due to the betrayal of this genius of the religion, or is it due to a basic weakness in the religion itself? And then he goes on to reflect about a visit that he has when he went to India, and he was having a conversation with a Hindu man, and this is right in the first chapter, and it's called Jesus and Interpretation. And he said when this gentleman asked him this question, it had a profound impact on him because he was raised in the seminary, he was raised in the Christian church, and so this Hindu proposed this question to him. And Pierre, I'm going to read this, and then I'm going to ask you to give me your perspective. Chapter 1 on Jesus and the Interpretation, Richard. It says here, more than 300 years ago, your forefathers were taken from the western coast of Africa as slaves. The people who dealt in the slave trade were Christians. One of the famous Christian hymn writers, John Sir Newton, made his money from the sale of slaves to the New World. He is the man who wrote Sweet the Name of Jesus Sound and Amazing Grace. And we all know Amazing Grace. There may be others, but these are the only ones I know. The name of one of the famous British slave vessels was Jesus. The men who brought the slaves were Christians. Christian ministers, quoting the Christian apostle Paul, gave the sanction of religion to the system of slavery. During all the periods since then, you have lived in a Christian nation in which you are segregated, lynched, and burned. Even in the church, I understand, there is segregation. He concludes here, I am Hindu. I do not understand. You are here in my country, standing deep within the Christian faith and tradition. I do not wish to seem rude to you, but sir, I think you are a traitor to all the darker peoples of the earth. And I am wondering what you, an intelligent man, can say in the defense of your position. So, Pierre, I want to ask you, in your opinion, how can black people justify practicing a religion that was the religion of their oppressors?
Yes. Howard Thurman, a mentor of mine since I was in the service, and it was during that period that I became first acquainted with his work.
Mm-hmm.
He was written up as one of the only original religious thinkers in America. And this trip that he made to India was a
pilgrimage
and a soul shaking experience for him. Mm-hmm. He met with Howard. He met with Gandhi actually at the Khyber Pass, and Gandhi asked some very similar questions to Thurman, and but his answer to the question is what gave me a window into Thurman's thinking, and it began to alter my thinking.
Okay.
Thurman answered to Gandhi's question, one of Gandhi's questions, this way, because Gandhi wanted to know why is it that the American Negro chose Christianity for their faith, rather than Islam, when Islam has no class distinction based on race. And Thurman's answer was, it is because the American Negro likened their experience in America to that of the Hebrew Israelite in Egypt. Mm. And as Moses was the deliverer of his people, so too would Jesus be upon his return. Mm-hmm. So you can, and so Thurman clearly made a distinction between so-called Western Christianity as practiced by the imperial European colonial masters and the true teachings of Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. And that's what was an eye-opener for me.
And so when we had this conversation, this in-depth conversation about today's black church, and again, there is an underground of churches that, you know, speak from a different perspective than some of these churches on Preachers of L.A. or Reality, or who push this prosperity movement, mm-hmm. and trying to get Creflo Dollar, this $365 million plane. So talk about the disservice of the black church and focusing on the prosperity movement versus Jesus' ministry of liberation and being set free from our oppressors.
Yes, I think there was a turning point upon the assassination of Dr. King. Mm-hmm. I think Martin Luther King was clearly in the true teachings of Jesus in terms of setting free the oppressed, liberating the imprisoned, which is a theology of liberation. Mm-hmm. What King did, according to Professor Howard Harold Cohn, King gave the theology of liberation his Christian identity. Mm-hmm. Malcolm gave it his black identity. Mm-hmm. But it's the theology of liberation for the poor, the rejected, and the despised.
And he also said, I can count the number of many times that I've been in a black church and the majority of the population, you know, reflect the audience that Jesus was, you mm-hmm. know, speaking to, whether they're the homeless, you know, the disenfranchised, mm-hmm. the disinherited.
Yes.
Do you know what I mean? You know, you don't have a church mm-hmm. just for the homeless. You know what I mean?
Yes.
And this is who he was speaking to. So, Brakeel, before we move on to these final topics that we address this month, do you have any thoughts on the black church and how do we use that in terms of our healing from slavery if we are so disenfranchised from it, especially on Sundays during football season?
I think we just have to, you know, lean on God when we feel like, you know, we have no answers.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think there is definitely still value in a relationship with God and being a follower of Jesus Christ. We definitely have to remember that people are going to interpret and use the Bible, you know, in various ways,
mm-hmm.
but strengthening your own personal relationship, you know, with God, I think is important.
Okay.
And still believing in him and that he is real and that, you know, God can make a way when it doesn't seem like there is any way.
He can make a way out of
nowhere. These are things that we hear. But, you know, I believe it's true.
Absolutely.
You know, I have to believe in what the Bible says, despite, you know, people believing it's the white man's religion, you know, because
absolutely.
I believe God is real and I've seen his effect in my life.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I mean, and we're spiritual people by nature. So irrespective of, you know, what we practice, we're just spiritual people, you wanted to say.
Well, I think, and one of the distinctions Thurman makes in that text is there's a difference between Christianity and the religion of Jesus, right?
Okay.
And Christianity is about a set of doctrines, again,
very good.
That one receives and accepts and then repeats back, right? And that is ultimately oppressive because, again, there's no deep well of spirituality there. It's a form of indoctrination that's taking place. But when mm-hmm. we talk about the religion of Jesus, again, we're talking about having having that kind of deep questioning and that willing. I mean, Howard Thurman was considered a mystic, you know, yes. not just a theologian. Mm-hmm. Yes. And that's important because, again, he's raising those important kind of questions. And so in making the distinction between Christianity and the religion of Jesus, Thurman also makes a distinction between the ministry of Paul and the ministry of Jesus. Mm-hmm. And he says, look at Paul's social location. You know, Paul is a Roman citizen. Mm-hmm. Paul has certain privileges and rights that Jesus doesn't have. And okay. so Paul makes certain kinds of assumptions about the state of the world that Jesus doesn't make, you know. And so when we talk about Christianity and the doctrines that are built around Jesus, Thurman's like, no. What's the religion of Jesus himself?
Absolutely.
And let's follow that.
Absolutely.
And, you know, Jim Lawson, Reverend James Lawson, pastor emeritus of Holman Church, he always makes that emphasis. There's a difference between being a Christian and a follower of Jesus.
Very good.
And so when we talk about this liberation effort, the folks who are following Jesus are on that journey toward liberation. And that doesn't care whether you're Dr. King or whether you're Malcolm X.
Very good.
That view of Jesus is a right. liberating one, and we can ride that.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I highly recommend any of you who are not familiar with Jesus and the Disinherited to please I ordered it. I didn't find it in a bookstore, though you may find it in some black bookstores, but I want to thank Pierre publicly for giving me this jewel, because one of the reasons you gave it to me,
it's a pleasure and an honor,
because one of the reasons you gave it to me
as it is,
is because you said it made Jesus human for
yes,
you.
Yes, Thurman answered the question,
and I need Jesus
yes.
to be human for me.
Absolutely.
Okay. Yes. If I'm trying to heal, I need to be able yes. to be, make him relatable, and that this book absolutely makes him relatable.
Because yes, Jesus yes. deals with the trauma too.
Yes, he does.
You know, and when we talk about the oppressive system that he's in and how he engages that trauma and what he teaches around how to engage that trauma, that's a liberating kind of Jesus. Mm-hmm. But just a pie in the sky, there's nothing liberating about that.
Right.
That's ultimately passive, and nothing about that we can organize around to effectively change this
All
world
right.
that we're
and before we move on to the last minute, I want you to make those distinctions that you said about King in terms of segregation and integration, because one of the questions that we asked was, well, when we talked about Black Wall Street, like, you know,
yeah.
should we have, you know, kept ourselves segregated? I mean, in terms of integration, but you made a great distinction.
Yeah, I mean, similarly, I mean, I don't think we understand who Jesus is similar to King, because when King became a national holiday, Dr. King's birthday became a national holiday, and got co-opted, you know, by empire, we have a false impression of who King is. The same thing happens with Jesus. And I think we have a understanding of King that's off base, especially when we talk about desegregation and integration.
Mm-hmm.
For most of us, when we talk about organizing in the movement coming out of the 60s and into the 70s, I had a professor in undergrad who was very philosophy professor in undergrad who was very clear that what happened to us is we stopped because we thought we won.
Yes.
All right. We thought because we thought we had overcome, mm-hmm. and there was not more work to do. But yet we still had the vestiges of white supremacy and black inferiority that we're wrestling with.
Mm-hmm.
And so one of the things that in actually reading Dr. King's work, which we don't do, we listen to sound bites like everybody
yes,
else. We
right.
take what's presented to us wholesale, and we don't think critically and read and look at actually at the text himself that he
what
wrote.
What he actually wrote.
What he actually wrote. What mm-hmm. is the theory behind this? And so one of the things that Dr. King wrote about was a distinction between desegregation and integration. He talks about segregation as being a system that is evil and unjust and inherently creates a hierarchy, a racial hierarchy that must be challenged. Desegregation changes the rules to create the opportunity for just relations between peoples of different races and cultures. And integration is the process of genuine interpersonal and intergroup doing, creating the beloved community, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so with that kind of conception, then when three black people go to a predominantly white school, that school might be desegregated, but that's not an integrated school.
Mm-hmm.
It just means it's no longer, it's not the law for the races to be separated.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that becomes important, because if we believe that desegregation is the end of the work, then we don't realize that that's just when the work begins. Because that's when we start trying to create the kind of justice, because the laws don't prohibit us doing that.
Very good.
And so again, when we have that re-understanding, when we get to know our ancestors a little bit more, right, and know what they were really fighting for, I think that can give us a kind of conception of what to work with as we make our stride to our freedom as well.
Fantastic. And real quickly, we had talked about Willie Lynch, and just to kind of recap some of the things that we had talked about. And real quickly, Raquel, in terms of the black family, what are some of the things that we need to do in order to heal the black family?
To heal the black family, I mean, the same thing. I mean, I think we need to help, you know, restructure the relationship between the mother and the father.
Mm-hmm.
You know, have the man be the head of the household. You know, teach kids how to be in healthy relationships, mm-hmm. you know, in marriages. And
by example,
not be afraid to get married.
Right, absolutely, absolutely. Because it does seem like here on the West Coast, marriage is a bad word. Thank you. But in terms of, and last week, and real quickly before we go, we talked about Black Wall Street. Talk about the importance of recycling Black dollars and our economic mobility.
It's absolutely necessary. You know, and it ties into your earlier question about the family. There's an African proverb that speaks to the communal value. It says this. It's in these words. It says, "I am because we are, mm-hmm. and because we are, I am." Mm-hmm. And we've been seeded with this false idea of selfish, self-centered, self-seeking, extreme individualism, and mm-hmm. it's in conflict with our ancestor value of "I am because we are." Okay. And if the Black man go home and look in his wife's eye and say, "I am because we are." And because we are, I am, they're inseparable.
Absolutely fantastic. Inseparable. You real quickly, you want to say something?
I just wanted to invite folks to come out. Okay. They want to continue
Very
the faith
good.
Discussion.
Absolutely. So
we'll have a
thank you ahead. So much. Thank you so much, Dr. Quarles. Dr. Quarles, thank you so much for calling in and sharing with this conversation. Again, Underground comes on tonight on WGN, so check your local listings. And Victor has created a faith study guide based on the first four episodes, and this is going to continue. And you have some conversations that are happening locally here by Underground.
Yeah, if you want to keep part of this conversation with Underground from a faith perspective, join us on the Freedom Train. Tomorrow night we'll be at Westminster Presbyterian Church, 2230 Jefferson Boulevard, from 6:30 to 8. We'll be at Holman Church next week, April the 7th, but you'll find out more at rebirthlive.net.
And you said once you go to each of these churches are being seen as...
Every church is a safe house.
Every church is a safe
so
house.
So nobody owns this movement. We're all doing this together. And so come and join us, and let's grow together and let's break free.
Fantastic. And that's at rebirthlive.net. How can people find you, Pierre?
www.goldenagepublication.wordpress.com. And we are there promoting and posting the literary heritage of our African ancestors, the greatness of the empire of Songhai, Ghana, Mali. And brother asked earlier, where are we going back to? We're going back to who we never left ourselves. We're going back to self.
We'll be going back to self. And we need to go back to self in order for us to be able to heal. Thank you all so much for joining us for this five-week series. And for tonight's show, we concluded with our discussion on the healing of how do we heal from slavery and racism. We're going to launch a brand new series for the month of April starting next week with our series on look at the different religions. And so we're going to be talking to some preacher's kids next week on The Dialogue. So make sure you tune in with me, Starlett Quarles, signing off as my mama's child and my daddy's baby girl. Until next week, God bless you.
Network, original reality radio, handcrafted for your listening and viewing pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk. Stay tuned.